Good morning to everyone. Thank you for coming to this AnividiaNet webinar. This webinar will be focused on the regulatory framework on orphan drugs products for rare disease. This webinar is doing in the context of a program studied by AnividiaNet and Aniridia Europe, involving discussions on topics relevant to Aniridia with the goal of engaging professional working in this field as well as the general public. Our speaker today is Gloria Palomo. Good morning, Gloria. Thank you for coming today. Gloria holds a BSc in biochemistry and is an enthusiastic of neuroscience and molecular biology, with where the topics followed in her postgraduate studies. During her PhD studies at Universidad Autónoma de Madrid, Gloria was focusing her work on a rare disease, the Friedreich ataxia, where she uncovered a new mechanism, underlined neuronal cells did and contribute to the proof of concept studies for the gene therapy of this disease. During her postdoc in Weill Cornell Medicine in New York, she worked in ALS and the pathological mechanism of the disease associated with mitochondrial quality control. Gloria is currently not clinical assessor in the Vaccine and Advanced Therapies Service in the Spanish Agency for Medicinal Products and Medical Device, and is member from Spain in the Committee of Orphan Medicinal Products of EMA. Gloria, thank you very much for coming today to be the speaker, and please go ahead with your presentation.
Okay. Okay, here we go. Okay, I hope you can hear me well and you can see the presentation. Maybe
yes.
For the sake of time, I should start, okay, because I don't see it here, but I guess if everyone is okay, I'll start.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. So I just want to thank the organizers for the invitation, for having me here today, and to bring giving me the opportunity to share the work we are doing continuously at the Committee for Orphan Medicinal Products. I have always felt close to the rare disease community because I have friends that suffer a rare disease, and also because at the professional level I have always been working in this field, first as a researcher and now as a regulatory in the regulatory perspective. I also hope that this webinar is useful and the information that we are going to share here today can be used. Yes, maybe someone is perhaps preparing a non-clinical plan or a clinical trial in Aniridia, in this disease, and maybe this information is useful just in case they are planning to apply for an orphan designation. So we can start. You can see the new slide, right? Yes, perfect, because I don't see it. Okay, so we should first have a look at the current picture of rare diseases in the European Union, and that is that there are more than 6,000 rare diseases affecting 30 million patients, and the results from the study supporting the evaluation of the orphan regulation shown that 95% of these rare diseases currently do not have a treatment option. So you see that still many things to do in this field. This situation was different 20 years back, a little bit more, in at the beginning of the century, because we didn't have a regulatory framework for all the European Union that might help to the development of these orphan medicinal products. And that was different to what was actually happening in other regions, like in the US, in Japan and Australia, that to say some, that they have regulatory frameworks that help in the development of these medicines and that prove to be really efficient in doing that. So patients with a rare disease deserve medicines of the same quality, safety and efficacy as any other disease. And the orphan legislation was conceived to help these medicines to pass through all the difficulties they need to face and they are facing continuously to get on the market. The first one is because they are intended for a small population. So the main spirit of the legislation was to foster development, to procure medicines to treat rare diseases. And with that in mind, the orphan legislation came in the year 2000. Here we have the participation of different partners, regulatory, patients, other stakeholders, etc. So I have to say two important things at this point is that the legislation is based on incentives. That means that we try to incentivize the development of the orphan medicinal products. And also that this legislation is implemented in all the countries of the European Union. So the medicines that go through this pathway are authorized through this pathway. They have a registration in all the countries. That's different from availability, but at least they are registered in all the countries. So what is the regulatory pathway for an orphan medicinal product? Well, everything is described in the orphan regulation. That is the first one that you have here, the 4141/2000. Some months later, we have the other regulation, that is 847/2000. This one was clarifying some points of the first one, that is the orphan regulation. But in any case, both of them, they have a clear definition of several points that we need to know before we go into further discussions. And the first one is that from a regulatory perspective, a rare disease is a life-threatening or chronically debilitating disease that affects not more than 5 per 10,000 persons. That's for the European Union. The orphan medicinal products are those intended to prevent, diagnose, or treat a rare disease. And I said the three, prevent, diagnose, or treat. We will see that later. And those medicines are identified through the orphan designation. That is is something that is done by the Committee of Orphan Medicinal Products that is also created and defined in this orphan regulation. So once we have this clear, then how can we proceed? Well, I just said that the products are identified through the orphan designation, and this is done by the COMP. That means that the product has a potential or has the potential to be used in the orphan condition, but does not have a marketing authorization or a therapeutic indication. That's different, and we will see that later too. Usually, these products are presented at very early stages of development. I mean, the designation can be granted at any stage, but usually it is done very early because the orphan designation comes with some benefits. The most important here is that the enhanced regulatory support in the form of protocol assistance. This is a specific scientific advice that is done for the orphan medicinal products. Other incentives are fee reduction or the possibility to apply to certain grants that require the orphan designation, national measures, etc. So different incentives. But with the incentive also come the obligations, and that is that sponsor need to submit to EMA an annual report on the state of development of the product. Okay, so once the committee has the positive opinion and once the European Commission confirms this and is responsible for the legally binding act that affects the European Union, then EMA published the PSO, that's the Public Summary of Opinion. That's a document with the most important information regarding the designation. And then the product is included in the Community Register of Orphan Medicinal Products. And this is done by the European Commission. So We said that the product was at very early stages of development, then it's taking some time, it's developed, and hopefully reaches the marketing authorization stage. Well, at this point, the committee has to check again and be sure that the product still meets all the criteria and fulfills all the criteria that are laid down in the regulation. And that's the stage of maintenance of the orphan designation. So the important point here is that there are two steps. First, the initial designation, and then the maintenance. There are two possibilities here. If the orphan designation, is not maintained, then the product can still be marketed. Always done, there is a positive benefit risk assessment done by the Committee for Human Medicinal Products or the Committee for Advanced Therapies. If hopefully the orphan designation is maintained, then the product, if has a positive benefit risk assessment, it is marketed as an orphan, and that entitles to the biggest benefit or the biggest incentive on the of the orphan legislation, that is the 10 years of market exclusivity that can be extended for additional 2 years just in case the pediatric investigation plan is completed. Once we are at this point, the EMA published the OMAR, that is the Orphan Maintenance Report, and the Community Register shows the changes in the status of the product. Okay, so we have mentioned several times the Committee for Orphan Medicinal Products, but what is this entity, the Committee for Orphan Medicinal Products? Well, we are the committee responsible for all the recommendations regarding the orphan medicinal products. And the most important thing to say is that we are a scientific committee and that we work for the patients. We were the first committee at EMA that had among the members patient representatives with equal rights to the other members, full voting rights, everything, and they are part of us. We cannot distinguish between members, they are part of us. So what we are doing all the time? Well, we do all the scientific assessments for the designations, for the protocol assistance. We do all the scientific discussions. We write papers, participate in workshops, webinars like this one. Very important, we assist the Commission on establishment and development of policy on orphan medicinal products, everything. And we are the chair, our dear chair, the vice chair, one member per each member state, 27 after the Brexit, three patient representatives, three experts that are nominated by the European Commission, and we have one member per Norway, per Iceland, and per Liechtenstein. We have observers from EURORDIS, from the European Commission itself, and very, very important to us, the EMA Secretariat, the Orphan Office that are the persons that help us always with the scientific assessments, and also the COM Secretariat that help us with agendas, documents, meetings, WebEx connection, everything. We could not work without them. And this is us. We took this picture in the last face-to-face meeting we had. That was the month before the pandemic was declared, and we were at the new building of EMA in Amsterdam. And we took this picture for the Rare Disease Day. That's why we are all showing our hands. And I hope soon we can resume the face-to-face meeting because we have not seen each other in more than 2 years. Okay, and don't be scared by this slide. These are the technical documents that if you are thinking about applying for an orphan designation, you will need to check the regulations for the orphan medicinal products, also for the pediatrics, is very important, and different communications for the European Commission that help us to clarify some aspects of the regulation, and also documents that we, the COMP, work to help also the sponsors in the dossiers. Okay, and if we talk about the international liaison, we are not the only ones fighting rare diseases, and we work in close collaboration with other regions. That's the case, for example, of the FDA and the Japanese Ministry of Health, Labor and Welfare. In the case of the FDA, we have, with Japan the same, but we have exchange of information continuously. For the FDA, we had a common procedure for applying for orphan designation, meaning that the sponsors can use the same template to apply for both designations in the FDA and in Europe. And that's to reduce the workload of the sponsors. We had parallel assessment for the scientific advice, etc. With Japan, it's a little bit more complicated because, of course, to Japan, you need to submit things in Japanese. That complicates a little bit the things, but we still work with them all the time. And of course, we always work with Eurordis. They always attend our meetings and they assist us also through the patient office at EMA every time we need to talk to some patient regarding one specific disease or one specific condition. We always have support from them. If you want to know a little bit more about this, you can check this paper from one of our colleagues from the orphan office, from Segundo Mariz, that explains very well all these interactions with the FDA and Japan. And just only few points that we need to consider the differences between different regions. For example, in the FDA, a disease is considered rare if it affects less than 200,000 people. That's more or less equivalent to 7 per 10,000. And that means that, for example, a disease can be considered rare in the US and maybe not in the European Union because our threshold for prevalence is a little bit different. They also use biomarkers when defining the condition. And they don't have anything like the significant benefit that for us is one of the cornerstones of the legislation. And you can see here data. These are the applications that we have in the year 2021. That's the last that we have analyzed so far. And we received a total of 251 applications that resulted in 170 commission decisions. And you can see that many of them cluster in this group of congenital, familial, and genetic disorders, followed by nervous system disorders and blood and lymphatic system disorders. If we do the same exercise, but instead of using the last year, we consider from the implementation of the orphan regulation, so that is year 2000 up to now, 2021, we have a total of 207 initial marketing authorizations for orphan medicinal products and 38 extension of indication. That includes everything. So the products that are currently active, those that were withdrawn at the request of the sponsor, for example, one product that was revoked, the marketing authorization, and those that were removed from the registry because, because the market exclusivity expired after the 10 years. If we do the same analysis than before and we classify all these applications in the different subgroups according to Metra, we could see that many of them go to this big group of neoplasms, benign and malignant, we can say oncology in general, and congenital, familial, and genetic disorders. Regarding the type of products, well, in the committee we see everything. We see chemicals, we see advanced therapies, cell therapies, gene therapies, we see antibodies, monoclonal antibodies, we also see specific oligonucleotides, so we see everything. We do all kinds of products. If we take from those the active one and do the same classification, we can see that in total we have right now 150 in the last year, 17 new applications, and they all go to the same groups of congenital, familial, and genetic, and oncology. It's interesting that they are followed by infections and infestations, and we will see that later that we have one publication on this regard. This is the community register of orphan medicinal products. Actually, there are two web pages, one for the products that are active and one for the products that are not active anymore, but at some point in their history, they were part of the community register. So you can just type in here. In this case, I did a search for Alofisel, that is a cell therapy product. This product originally started in Spain. And once you do the search, you can see that if you click here, you will see all the documents that are related to this product. In this case, it is currently authorized. So we have the trade name and the date of authorization. The designation date is also shown here, so you can see that almost 10 years span from the designation to the final marketing authorization. But for the development, probably more than 10 years, because at that stage you need data to support the designation. I also checked for aniridia, and there's one product with an orphan designation, ataluren, but I didn't find anything else for this condition. Okay, so now that we have clear more or less the whole picture for the rare diseases and for the orphan medicinal products, we can go step by step in the orphan designation. I have to say that there are four pillars for the orphan designation, and they are all clearly shown in this article from the orphan regulation. There are four, like I said. The first one is the condition that it is shown here, a life-threatening or chronically debilitating condition. We have also the point for the prevalence, affecting not more than 5 in 10,000 persons. We have an additional criterion for designation, that is the return of investment, that is explained in this paragraph. We will enter into details later. We have the medical plausibility, the third pillar, and this is shown here, like the product. It is intended for the diagnosis, prevention, or treatment. And of course, one of the most important points, the identification of satisfactory methods and the significant benefit that is shown here in this paragraph. So this is the criteria for designation. You can also see this publication of the committee. It is very clearly explaining here and very detailed, and it goes straight to the point. But you can also check in the EMAS website. Here is the link. They have this very nice decision tree, and you know your product, you know your condition, so you can start in this point and then answering to these questions that go through all the pillars of the designation, and you can see in which stage you are and if you are ready or not to apply for the designation, or maybe you need to complete some of the parts or dedicate more time to others, etc. So we can start with the first one, a distinct medical entity or subset, that is the condition. And you can see here with the data that we continue to designate new conditions. That has not changed over time. In the last year, 1/5 of all our designations were for conditions that were not designated before by the committee. We have some examples like diamond black fan anemia, adenosine deaminase 2 deficiency, but I mean, many, every month we have new conditions. And we need to dedicate some time to explain what is an orphan condition and what is a therapeutic indication, because those two are completely different and they do depend on different committees, but they interact. So we need to be clear what is what and how we can deal with this interaction. So, for example, when we are talking about conditions, in the working documents, we have this definition. I'm going to read. Any deviation from the normal structure and function of the body as manifested by a characteristic set of signs and symptoms, typically a recognized distinct disease or a syndrome. That would mean, for example, pediatric and adult forms of growth hormone deficiencies. Well, if to this condition we apply the criteria for designation according to the Article 3 that we just saw before, then we have the orphan condition that is designated as growth hormone deficiency. Then, if we have the information of the product, we can say that the product is intended for diagnosis, prevention, or treatment. In this case, the orphan indication would be treatment of growth hormone deficiency. And that's the responsibility of the comp. We establish the condition, the orphan condition, and the orphan indication. The orphan condition and the orphan indication. And then after the development of the product, once the pivotal clinical trials are done, then the CHMP with the sponsors, they both agree on the therapeutic indication that is part of the marketing authorization and is clearly described in the product information, in this case in section 4.1. And then we have, Grobecli is indicated for growth failure in children and adolescents aged from 3 years up to 18 years due to insufficient endogenous growth hormone secretion. Okay, what is important from here is that we always designate, because we see products at very early stages of development, so we always designate as broad as possible the condition, the orphan condition, So any therapeutic indication that results from the development of the product, because we cannot predict exactly in which population the product is going to be developed, then we do that, the broad orphan condition, so any therapeutic indication always will fall within the scope of the orphan designation, the orphan condition that has been designated. So in this case, it's pretty straightforward, but we have additional examples like orphan condition, tuberous sclerosis, orphan indication, treatment of tuberous sclerosis, and then in the therapeutic indication is mentioned angiomyolipoma associated with tuberous sclerosis complex and subependymal giant cell astrocytoma with tuberous sclerosis. But that is not that bad, because we have this other example that is more complex. We have the orphan condition lymphoplasmacytic lymphoma, treatment of lymphoplasmacytic lymphoma, and then this product, Brukinsa, as monotherapy, first point, is indicated for the treatment of adult patients with Waldenström macroglobulinemia, second point, who receive at least one prior therapy, third point, or are in first-line treatment for patients unsuitable for chemoimmunotherapy. What are these points? First one, we are opening up the possibility of combinations. We are talking about monotherapy, but we have seen combinations as well many times in the therapeutic indication. Sorry, we do not mention the condition in the therapeutic indication. We are talking about Waldenström macroglobulinemia patients that are included in the lymphoplasmacytic lymphoma patients, and we are talking about lines of treatment. So that's why it's really important that we always try to designate the broadest possible orphan condition. And that is one point that the sponsors need to understand, that we always go for the broader condition. Okay, so now that we have this, how to define the condition? Well, usually subsetting of common diseases with prevalence higher than 5 per 10,000 is generally not acceptable. What is this? We never do salami slicing, and we say always salami slicing because that's the best picture. We take a broad condition and we try to orphanize and separate populations in this condition. But this cannot be done because there is a clear definition of what is a condition for the orphan, for the purpose of the orphan designation, and that is that valid conditions are defined by the specific characteristics, pathophysiology, histopathological, and clinical characteristics. And those are necessary for the development of a medicinal product that indicates, in this case, the development is plausible based on the pathogenesis of the condition and the pharmacodynamic evidence. So this is very technical. We will see examples now. But I want you to take this message. So, also, different degrees or severity stages are not considered distinct medical entities, not a different condition, and we are not allowed to use biomarkers because we always have to consider the condition, the clinical characteristics, etc. And we don't go towards personalized medicine because that's my personal view. I think this is not related too much with the orphan disease because I think the patients with an orphan disease and a rare disease want to feel that they are part of the community and they're not alone, and that's quite different from the personalized medicine that otherwise is part of the future, but I think that should be considered separately. When we do subsetting and we consider subsets of common diseases, well, only when several characteristics, several points are fulfilled. In this case, if the patients of that subset present with a distinct and unique characteristics with a plausible link to the condition, that's very important. And those characteristics are essential for the medicinal product to carry out its action. So for example, that means if I'm subsetting a pancreatic cancer patient with HLA-A2, this HLA-A2, that is the expression of the major histocompatibility complex, this is not directly related to the condition. It's just a characteristic of the patients, and this is not the proper way to do subsetting. And very important as well is that the product does not work outside the subset. So only the patients with this subset, within this subset, will benefit from the product. Okay, so next examples. typical distinct medical entities. For example, we talk about the Hunter syndrome, pancreatic cancer, Krabbe disease. We use the umbrella term of spinal cord injury for traumatic spinal cord injury and incomplete spinal cord injury, new conditions like myopathic mitochondrial DNA depletion syndrome, megalencephalic leukoencephalopathy with subcortical cysts. We also use umbrella for epidermolysis bullosa, glioma. Subsets. Well, I discovered this one in the last presentation, partial, deep, dermal, and full thickness burns. We also designate subsets like high-grade B-cell lymphoma, that is a subset of diffuse large B-cell lymphoma, primary IgA nephropathy, idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, congenital lymphatic malformations, etc. There is a particular case in which we designate treatment modalities independent of the underlying condition. That's the case of, for example, solid organ transplantation or hematopoietic stem cell transplantation. And although we are talking about the first steps, the initial designation, I have to mention that a medicinal product can be authorized for orphan and non-orphan indications. This is not exclusive, but in that cases, there have to be two different marketing authorizations with different names, different pathways. They are completely separated because one is entitled to the incentives and the other one has the other, standard incentives that are applied to new products in the pharmaceutical legislation. And very important as well, you all know that many of the rare diseases affect children, and you can see here that many of the conditions that we designate affect both children and adults, and that's why we have very close interaction with our colleagues of the PDCO, the Pediatric Committee at EMA. If you want to know a little bit more about what we just said, like for example the use of the biomarkers, you can see this publication, or this one that is more recent that explain all that we just talk about with a lot more detail, and they are both very interesting. And then we can move forward to the second pillar of the designation, that is the prevalence. I have to say that we designate the full range of prevalence. We go from, for example, multiple myeloma with 464, that's very close to 5, to giant axonal neuropathy, that's 0.002. Those cases are particularly challenging because we have really few sources to calculate the designation, but we do, and the sponsors do, and we check and we designate these conditions that have this really low prevalence. And the good point of this is that you can see that in the last 5 years, a lot of the designations have been done in conditions that have a prevalence lower than one. And for me, that's a good point because that means in that conditions that have really few patients and are very rare, there are developments going on. And that's something that's encouraging for our work because we know that is something going on in these conditions. Two important points regarding the prevalence. Well, in this case, the prevalence outside the community that, for example, in the cases of communicable diseases like Ebola virus disease or Zika virus disease, we do not need to consider the prevalence outside the community, and even if zero or almost zero, we can designate them under the prevalence criterion, because in this case we consider the persons in the EU that are at risk, and that was the case of those monoclonal antibodies that were designated for the treatment for Ebola virus disease. And the other important point is that we have been talking about treatment, prevention, and diagnostic. And we see products for all indistinctively. We have much more treatment, of course, but we see products for the prevention or the diagnostic of rare diseases. And in this case, the only difference here is that we do not consider for the calculation of the prevalence, we do not consider the patients that have the condition. We consider for the prevalence the population that is expected to be exposed or to be administered with this product on an annual basis. And you can see here two examples of, in this case, this is a maintenance for the diagnosis of GEP-NET tumors and also initial designation for the prevention of bronchopulmonary dysplasia. And we mentioned before that there is one alternative criterion for the designation, that is the potential return on investment. That was the other paragraph of the Article 3. And this one states that it can be used for medicinal products that are intended for life-threatening or seriously debilitating or serious and chronic conditions, even if the prevalence is greater than 5. But, and that's important, always then the product is not probable that will generate enough return to justify the initial investment. And that's really difficult to calculate because we need to know all the development costs, the expected revenues, etc. And I said that is really difficult, and no designation has been ever granted on this criterion because it's really difficult to calculate. And upon the revision of the legislation that is currently going on, probably this criterion will disappear because it never has been used. Two more papers about the prevalence. One, this one on the left for all kind of diseases, and this one on the right on hematological diseases that you can imagine because there are many treatments in the last year, the prevalence is evolving, and we need to be always calculating again and again the prevalence. And then we go to the third point, the medical plausibility or the intention to treat, prevent, or diagnose. In reality, there are few things that can be said here because, I mean, this is completely dependent on the product, the condition, the treatment modality. I mean, if it's intended for treatment or prevention or diagnosis. So this is quite open, but even though it's quite open, there are few things that need to be very clear. And I took them from this publication of the committee, and there are three things. The first point is that we need a specific data with the product, the product that is applied for. Of course, there are situations in which this is not possible. Imagine an antisense oligonucleotide, for example, if we are testing this ASO in a valid model of the condition, in an animal model, we cannot use the human product. We have to use a species-specific product. In this case, it is understand that we can do extrapolation, but otherwise we need data with a specific product. And we need to know that the proposed product exists and is under development, so we can identify this stage of development. And for the medical plausibility, we usually work and do require non-clinical data and sometimes also preliminary clinical data in the condition, in patients of the condition. And also very important that the endpoints that are studied here have to be relevant in relation with the condition. For example, that means that if we are doing a gene therapy approach for a rare disease, we need functional endpoints, not only the expression of the protein, because the protein can be there, but it can be that it's doing nothing. So we need functional data, survival, motor coordination, behavior, etc. Okay, and well, this is for the initial designation, because at the time of maintenance of the orphan designation, the medical plausibility is confirmed by the positive benefit risk assessment that is done by the CHMP. There's no further, no confirmation beyond that, because that's the ultimate confirmation. Okay. Two publications for non-clinical, for rare neurological conditions, and also for infectious diseases that we mentioned before, that there was a large group of applications that clustered in this group. And then we reach one of the most important points of our legislation, that are the satisfactory methods and the significant benefit. Like I said, this is the cornerstone, one of the cornerstones of our legislation, and is unique to the European orphan regulation, and we define the significant benefit as a clinically relevant advantage or a major contribution to patient care. So there are two options here. The first thing that we need to do is to identify satisfactory methods of treatment, diagnosis, or prevention. That will depend on what is doing our product. For the treatment or of the condition. In this case, I wrote here treatment of the condition. If there are satisfactory methods at initial orphan designation, we work with assumptions. We assume and we work with the preliminary data that has been generated with the medical plausibility, and we compare this data with the data that is already available for the satisfactory methods, or maybe in the non-clinical data we have two groups and we compare one with the satisfactory methods and one with other product. I mean, there are many, many possibilities here, but we do an assumption because the data is very preliminary. And that means that at the time of maintenance, we are not doing assumptions anymore. We are doing assessment. That means that we need robust data that has to be generated with the product. Full stop. We need data. If there are no satisfactory methods of treatment, we are in this other branch. And then, for example, at initial orphan designation, we don't need any special discussion because if there is nothing authorized, there is nothing authorized. And then we reach the marketing authorization, the maintenance, and then if still there is nothing authorized, we cannot do any assessment because there are no products, satisfactory products for the treatment, diagnosis, or prevention. But there is another possibility, is that in between these two, the initial and the maintenance, something is authorized for the condition. And then we will have to go to this other side of the graph, and we need to do an assessment of the data that has been generated with our product and compare it with the data with the other product. So sponsors should be aware and should be vigilant in their conditions, because maybe at the time of initial there is nothing, but later on something is approved and then they have to do the significant benefit. You can see that this is very important to us because 2/3 of the opinions are based on significant benefit assessment. And this number is not changing at all in the last 5 years. So we are always doing significant benefit. It's really important to us, and it's a very very important part of our assessments. So this is a two-step approach, right? So first we need to identify the satisfactory methods, and then we do the assessment of the significant benefits. So generally, satisfactory equals authorized through the national or centralized procedure. That means that if one product is authorized in one member state, then we have to consider it if satisfactory, like a satisfactory, if it's compliant with the other definition, that is that the product has a positive benefit risk in the orphan condition or addresses at least the same set of symptoms of the disease. There has to be a clear mention of the condition, symptoms in the approved product information. And that's for medicinal products, but there are other methods that are not authorized, like medicinally authorized, let's say, like radiotherapy, surgery, medical devices, or even diet that are considered satisfactory because there is a scientific evidence of the efficacy and safety. That is the case, for example, of diet in phenylcetonuria. Another example is allogenic hematopoietic stem cell transplantation in the patients of paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobinuria. We also consider magistral formula, officinal formula, if they are well known and general practice in the EU, but this is not really common, but I mean, it's written, so there can be considered. And what are not satisfactory methods for sure are those products generated through the hospital exemption clause and products that are used off-label. And it's our responsibility and responsibility of the sponsors to know which products are authorized in the disease and go check all the product information. So once we have the satisfactory methods, then we go to the assessment of the significant benefit that we just said. It can be clinically relevant advantage or major contribution to patient care. To consider this one, we have to be sure that the proposed product has at least equivalent efficacy and safety to the other ones, because if not, it makes no sense. Maybe a better administration, but if it's less efficient or less, the efficacy is lower, then we are not doing anything in favor of the patients. Also important, because at initial orphan designation, many times we consider alternative new mechanism of action as the assumption for significant benefit. But that's at initial orphan designation. At the time of maintenance, we need this to be translated into data to support either the clinically relevant advantage and or the major contribution to patient care. So how we do the assessment practically? Well, To identify the methods, we go to the product information, specifically to the wording in section 4.1 of a summary of product characteristics. This is a real example. We were assessing Aspaveli, and there were two products authorized in the orphan condition, Ultomiris and Solidis. In this case, we compare the three and we reach the conclusion that the target patient populations, despite these differences on the therapeutic indication, these target populations overlap, so we consider both as satisfactory methods. And then we do the assessment, that is the second part. In this case, we took clinical trial data, a direct comparison, because I don't remember exactly if it was Solidis. I think so. It was used as the active control in this clinical trial of Aspaveli. So we took data direct comparison from the trial, and then it was presented an indirect comparison with the other one. And in this case, there are some publications that explain you how to do this, because you need to adjust the patient population and differences that can be evident in the clinical trials, but this is also accepted by the committee. In this case, we didn't need it, but it's there is a claim of major contribution to patient care, then we need also the patient-reported outcomes. And with all this, the committee concludes or not in the clinically relevant advantage or the major contribution to patient care. You can go and see this paper as well in the satisfactory methods and the assessment of the significant benefit that has changed a little bit since the year 2000 up to now. Okay, so once we have our orphan designation, what are the benefits that I can get, the incentives that I can apply for or that are granted with the orphan designation? Well, we have the pre-authorization incentives, protocol assistance, the grants, the fee reduction. This is a graph that is showing that in the year 2013-2014, there was a huge increase in the number of designations that reached the committee, because I think it was necessary to have the orphan designation to apply to several grants, several European grants. So this is one incentive. But the most important is the post-authorization, is the market exclusivity, that is something that is only granted to orphan medicinal products. And in this case, we need to consider three different points here. The safeguard clause, that says that the market exclusivity that we mentioned before is 10 years and can be other 2 years can be added to these 10 years if there is a pediatric investigation plan completed. Well, with the safeguard clause says that the market exclusivity can be reduced to 6 years if at the end of the fifth year the criteria for designation are no longer met. We will see that procedure. And there are two other points, the similarity and the derogation. That's really the important, because the similarity says that no marketing authorization applications can be accepted by either the community or any member state in 10 years for the same therapeutic indication in regards to a similar medicinal product. But this clause can be broken by the derogation in three specific situations. The first one is that the marketing authorization holder of the first product gives consent. The second one is that the first original marketing authorization holder is not capable to provide sufficient product. And the third one is that if the second product can demonstrate that it's safer, more effective, or otherwise clinically superior. So, and start with the safeguard clause. This is not a standard procedure. This is not something that we do routinely. So once the products are granted, or they maintain the orphan designation, once they are authorized, they are granted the 10 years of market exclusivity, and this is not reviewed. But there is this procedure that can be initiated at the request of a member state when there is one signal that at least one of the original designation criteria may no longer be met. In that case, at that moment, that has to be by the end of the fifth year, then the committee assess again this application with If there is new information, with the new information, we just follow the same standards that we explained before. So there is nothing new here, but this is a very complicated procedure with different steps. I'm not going to enter into details, but the important thing is that this is not something that is done routinely. So I think there is this only one procedure, Plenadren, hydrocortisone for the treatment of adrenal insufficiency. This is taken from the minutes of the COM minutes, and that was initiated at the request of the United Kingdom. And it turned out that the criteria were fulfilled and the market exclusivity was not reduced to 6 years, and it kept going until 10 years. And then the similarity and the derogation. Like I said, the article says that the community and the member state shall not, for a period of 10 years, accept any marketing authorization application for a medicinal product, the second product, which is similar to the already authorized medicinal product, and it's intended for the same condition. And this procedure has been done several times. The responsible body will depend on the route of marketing authorization that is chosen for the second product. We have two options. The second product goes through national procedure, and for national, I mean pure national, decentralized or mutual recognition procedure. I have this example here, tobramycin, that was submitted through the centralized procedure. And that was escalated up to the CHMP because the member state did not reach an agreement. And there is a procedure that is common for any cases, not only orphans, that if there is disagreement, this can be sent to the CHMP. So they took a decision on that. And the other one is that the route of marketing authorization for the second product is via centralized procedure. And we have this example, it's the last year, zanabrutinib, and was compared to ibrutinib. And in this case, the responsible body is the CHMP that you can see here. This is also from the minutes. Finally, they adopted a derogation report because they examined, and this product, zanabrutinib, was in the third situation when they can demonstrate that it's safer, it's more has more efficacy, or is otherwise clinically superior. So these two products are are authorized. Not sure if they are marketed. And I'm almost done. I just want to use the last minutes of this presentation to let you know that this orphan legislation is currently under evaluation because, almost 20 years. So we need to know if this is working. And we went through different stages, different steps. We are now in the last one. We are awaiting the legislative proposal that is expected by the end of this year. It was supposed to happen at the beginning of 2022, but it turns out that the pharmaceutical strategy for Europe is also being reviewed, and it is expected to have a proposal by the end of the year. And one of the pillars of this revision of the pharma strategy are the unmet medical needs, and in that, rare diseases and orphan medicinal products have much to say. So they were both coupled, and we expect something that there is no disagreement between the orphan and the common pharmaceutical legislation. Sorry. So for you to know, the assessment took place at the end of the at the beginning of 2018, more or less. And it turns out, I'm not going to show you details, but there were a lot of medicines that came into the market because of the legislation. So it was a success, but there are still some points that need to improve. And that's why there were identified some points that need more work and need to be better improved in the new legislation to get much more medicines reaching the patients. And those were, for example, insufficient development in areas of greatest unmet medical need. We said at the beginning that 95% of the rare diseases do not have treatment option. That needs to be improved. Also, the availability and accessibility is various across the member states. So medicines are authorized in all the member states, but the accessibility and availability is different. Unfortunately, we mentioned also that some scientific and technological developments cannot be implemented in our decisions, in the COM decisions. That's, for example, the biomarkers. And some procedures are really not efficient and will disappear. That's the case of the alternative criteria of return of investment. And those were the things that were proposed, for example, to change or to have one criteria for medical needs, to develop a dedicated scheme for these areas of greatest unmet medical needs, or improve the faster generic availability once the market exclusivity is expired, well, et cetera, the different things. And those were, let's say, were several of these points were translated into several proposals that are currently being tested in an exercise. And with that, I mean that, for example, we have four options, and in each option we are changing some of the criteria of the legislation to see how this will affect product development. In this case, for example, in the option one, we are changing the market exclusivity, and now instead of being 10 years, one size fits all, then we have variable duration. We are testing, well, we are, the contractors are also testing, for example, if we should do changes in the threshold for the prevalence, if we should use incidence, if in option three, we should include another new incentives for rare and pediatric diseases. And then option number four is a completely change from what we actually know in the legislation. So we'll see, we expect that by the end of this year and new legislation coming soon. And I'm almost done, that's the last slide. So I just want to wrap up by reminding you that the European Orphan Regulation aims at fostering development of the products that are intended for rare diseases, and that the COMP is the body responsible for the recommendations of orphan medicinal products. And if we go to more detail, we have 17 new marketing authorizations for orphan products in the year 2021. Making a total of 207 orphan medicinal products centrally authorized in 148 different orphan conditions. That's it. Thank you so much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Gloria, for this interesting webinar that is focused on the orphan drugs, and also for visualizing the important and the relevant role of the Committee of Orphan Medicinal Products. There are some questions, so we can start with the first. The first question is, I am impressed by number of initial marketing authorization applications that are removed after expiration of the market exclusivity period. Is there a reasonable explanation for this?
Yes. I think we have to differentiate. We have initial marketing authorizations for orphan products, and those products are entitled to 10 years of market exclusivity. They are included, or they were already included, and they are confirmed in the Commission registry, in the European Union Registry for Orphan Medicinal Products. But once the market exclusivity is expired, this product is removed from this registry. This doesn't mean that the product is not on the market anymore. That means that it's not entitled to more exclusivity because it reached the maximum possible. So the product is still there, is authorized, of course, is marketed, it is there, but I mean, the incentives are expired. They use it, and that's it.
Okay, thank you. I think that now it's more clear, this aspect. Another question is, what are the most critical review areas of the orphan drugs application?
Well, at initial, for example, We have plenty of discussions regarding the medical plausibility because we need to be sure that the product has a potential, because I mean we are working with preliminary data, but we need to know that has the potential to be used in the condition. That's very important. And well, the other areas like the condition, the prevalence is equally important too. And in the case of the significant benefit, we work with assumptions at initial, but we need to be sure that the product, the sponsor in this case, is aware that there are other products and that they show potentially a better efficacy compared to the other ones. So I think at initial, these two, the medical plausibility and the significant benefit, are more important, but of course, prevalence and the condition are equally important. And then at marketing, usually the very important point, because we don't do the medical plausibility because we accept the benefit risk assessment, that's the ultimate confirmation that the product works in the condition. But the most important points are the prevalence. We have to be sure that over the years the prevalence has not changed, or if it's changed, still is meeting the criteria, and we need the thorough assessment of the significant benefit. Those are the two major points at maintenance.
Okay, thank you very much. I will read another question of the people that were here the webinar. Thank you very much, Gloria. It was a very interesting webinar. My question is, what is the best timing for orphan drugs application throughout drug development?
Yes, so application can be done at any moment. It has to be done before marketing authorization. That way you can apply for the fee reduction and you can apply for the centralized procedure, and then the medicine can enjoy, if it's positive in the orphan designation, can enjoy the market exclusivity. But before marketing authorization is a very long period of time. So I would say that we need data to support the medical plausibility, and this data is also necessary to support the significant benefit. So we need data at that moment. Okay. Usually what we see is non-clinical data, so proof of concept that the product can be used in the condition, and then many times we also see preliminary clinical data. That would depend on the product, the condition, etc. So I would recommend in this case, if there is any development going on, you can go to the EMA website and go to the, well, you can check all the information that is there. It's a very complete web page, but you can go to the decision tree and answer yes or no, and more or less you will have an idea at which point you are. Also, the benefit of applying at early stages means that you can enjoy also the protocol assistance, and you can receive scientific advice from EMA. In the case of academia and small and medium enterprises, is free of charge, and you can have this for the development of the quality, the non-clinical part, the clinical part. So it's very useful for the development. So I would say that you need to have data so we can really assess the application, but don't go too early, but don't go too late.
Okay.
I made myself clear.
Okay, and now we will go to the last question. Does an orphan medicinal product designation in the European Union qualify for an equivalent designation outside the European Union?
No. So those are independent procedures. So whatever is designated here is for the European Union. Whatever is designated in the FDA, it remains in the FDA. So what we usually see, because the sponsor have to submit the development plan, and they have to make the committee aware of the development plan and which designations they applied for, and many times you see that they are, or they already went to the FDA and now they are at EMA, or they first came to EMA and they are planning to go to the FDA, for example. But those are completely independent procedures. For the European Union, only the EMA procedure.
Okay. So we have to finalize this webinar. Thank you very much, Gloria, for this talk. And also, thank you for Aniridia to organize this webinar.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
It was a pleasure.
Okay. Bye.
Bye.